Hello everyone, I'm Michelle, a sports nutritionist, and welcome to my channel Diet Keto Lifestyle. This is yet another episode in the series of Low Carb Heroes of India. And today we have Dr. Tanmoy Das. He's an MD, he's a senior consultant and head department of anesthesiology at Apollo Gleneagles Hospital, Kolkata. He is a low-carb hero of India. He is a low-carb specialist doctor on dietdoctor.com. He is a lifestyle coach for chronic diseases at foodmed.in and Professor Tim Noakes Foundation. He also has a series of podcasts with the title, Are You As Healthy As You Can Be? He is extremely passionate about low-carb and nutrition, and I am really happy to have him here. So welcome, Dr. Das, and thank you for taking out the time.
Thank you, Michelle. Thank you very much for having me, and thank you for the kind introduction. I'm so happy to be here with you and share my thoughts. Tell me.
Thank you. So, share your thoughts. Right, we all have a journey that brings us into low carb. It's not that we were always doing a low carb diet. So, tell us about your journey. What got you into low carb?
Yes, actually, from what I have seen, people get into low carb in two ways. One is most common thing is it actually when it hits you personally, and the other is when you are really know about it and then do research in it. I'm a very much a hardcore doctor. I'm trained in one of the most rigorous disciplines of medicine, which is anesthesiology, which is a science which saves lives every day. We make it possible for surgeons to operate. We look after the lives of the patient as the surgeon operates. Like look after the brain, the heart, the kidneys, and at the end of the day we make sure that the patient is well and make anesthesia very safe. A line about anesthesia: it is perhaps the safest branch of medicine now, thanks to the science. The error in anesthesia is like a Six Sigma project error, less than one in 7 million error. So that way we save lives. We are cutting edge specialists. But at the end of the day, I have been wondering for many years, what am I really doing to know the root of the diseases? I have been noticing that every year, what is happening is the number of comorbidities in patients are going up. Almost every patient that I anesthetize, every patient that comes to the operating room is either has obesity, or hypertension, or diabetes, or cancer, or thyroid, or allergy, or a combination of these things. Even 5 years back, it used to be one or two diseases. Now, every patient has four or five comorbidities. And that realization was there. But what happened about 10 years back, I was personally affected. I had become very obese. My weight had gone up to 98 kg. You won't believe it if you see me now. And I was pre-diabetic. I had so many problems. I had bronchial asthma from a very long time. And I had, when I was working, I used to have knee joint problems, and I used to have acidity and a host of other issues. And one day while working, what precipitated things was I started having palpitations. And that was the time I kind of stopped and got a checkup done, which revealed I had huge amount of blood pressure, high blood pressure, and blood test revealed I was pre-diabetic. And I said, no, I will go home and take rest. The doctor usually advise, what they do, go to the cardiologist, go to the diabetologist and all that. So I kind of, stepped back and did some, this thought was there in my mind already that, previous to putting on weight and becoming sick, it's not that I was overeating. It's not that I was, doing whatever I wanted to eat and drink. And I never had that kind of a lifestyle. I was doing what we know in medical science, that you should eat healthy. You should eat small meals throughout the day. and whatever was known to be healthy, I was doing all that. But despite of going according to conventional medicine therapy, I had become sick. So that is what the question was there in my mind. Ki if I go according to the therapy of medical, conventional medical therapy, this is not going to cure me. This is not going to get me to the bottom of the thing. What will the diabetologist do? He will give me something to bring my sugar down. What will the cardiologist do? He will give me some blood pressure medication. So I, from my common sense, I had this thought that these are just like giving crocin for fever without knowing the cause of the whole problem. So I did a bit of research and I did know about a bit of it, but really went into it. And then that is how I discovered low carb specialists all over the world, starting from the famous nephrologist, Dr. Jason Fung, and then Professor Tim Noakes, and many other medical specialists who were doing it. And then others like fantastic medical journalists like Gary Topes, who was a difficult read, no doubt, but a lot of good research. And Nina Tycholz, she was also a medical journalist. So these were the first books which I came across. And, you know, as a medical person, what I do is even while reading the book, I go into the bibliography, you know, and look up the actual papers they had referred to. And so that is how I dig into the science and then verify what they have done, what they have read and all that. So after that, after a month of intense research, I immediately started going low carb. Means I had a talk with my family. I said, this is what it is going to be. And they agreed to cooperate. I'm very thankful. So I immediately gave up all the carbohydrates, good or bad, whatever you call it, that I was eating. Fortunately, I would say my coming from a Bengali family helped, because there are a lot of other eating options other than rice, the sabji and whatever vegetables. So that is how I started. And you won't believe it, within 15 days, I started noticing the difference. Yeah, initially for my blood pressure, I did start taking blood pressure medications. But for my pre-diabetes, I didn't have to do anything. That got reversed within 15 days. And my blood pressure stabilized. My palpitations went away. All this started happening within a month. And I started losing weight just about 2 months later. It took me less than 2 months. I lost... I don't take weight all the time, you know. So how I noticed first was that the size 40 pants, which I wish to wear, 40 or 42, I think, they have started becoming loose, and it just kept on happening till I will fast forward to 6 months after that. I had lost nearly 25 kgs in 6 months. Nothing. Unfortunately, because of my daily routine, I do not get, that's an excuse maybe, but I do not have time to, you know, do organized exercise like going to the gym and, you know, but I'm on my toes all day. I hardly ever get to sit down, sometimes perhaps in between cases, but I'm you know, going up the stairs, coming down the stairs, going from operating room to operating room the whole day. So I'm pretty active, but no organized exercise. That I have done for very few time periods in my life. But despite of that, I lost weight. I felt better. But that's it. I had just stopped snacking and I had stopped taking carbohydrates. So that itself made such a change that people had noticed. People started noticing. I noticed about myself. So I said, no matter what studies are there against, for me, N is equal to 1. That means I am, one study is enough. So sometimes N is equal to 1 works. So I started getting more and more confident about it, did more and more research. And as I did more research, more and more studies are there. It has been there since, I would say 50, 70 years, studies have been there for low carb, but it is just that it has got lost due to many reasons. So that's how it started. And till now, today I have been maintaining my waist size from 42 to 32 now, my weight 98 to 68, my GERD gone, my blood pressure medications most gone, no pre-diabetes. I feel much better, much active, much younger than what I was at the age of 20 or 21. So it's been a fantastic journey.
Excellent, Dr. Das. And it's so nice to know this, especially coming from a doctor. Like you said, it wasn't the lack of knowledge that you were putting on weight, or you yourself were facing pre-diabetes and hypertension. You had all the knowledge. You are a doctor yourself. You are seeing so many patients around you in this whole community. So in spite of the knowledge and in spite of the science, you did put on weight. You did face
The conventional
knowledge, right? And that is what really pushed you to explore what really is the reason as to why we are putting on weight and how to lose weight. So of course, weight loss is not the only thing. I always say that weight loss is something that just happens as you are targeting good health, because with weight gain, there are always health issues that come along. There is never that one has put on weight and there are no health issues. So once we try to get healthy in life, weight loss is something that just eventually happens as we go along. So that is what got you into it, and now you're extremely passionate about it and you are spreading awareness about this whole nutrition lifestyle that you are following, and you're expecting that you know, you can spread the word and as many people can get to benefit from this. So how long back was this? Since how long have you been practicing low carb?
I think from 2000, it has been 9 years, I think, 2012 February, January, I could say. It was 26th of January when I had that problem. So that was 2012 January. So yes, since then, I've been practicing the low carb. So it's quite some time now. And it has remained that way. And I, as what the weight you said, I also believe that a weight loss is secondary, because your body has a set clock, and which will, once your metabolism is set right, your body will automatically assume the weight which is best for you. So the real target of low carb is setting the metabolism right. You know, low carb is not a very casual thing. When you are going low carb, it means you are activating, these are scientific studies, mind you are activating a metabolic switch in the body. This metabolic switch is a huge subject of study nowadays. So what happens, you bring down your serum insulin levels. Once you bring down your serum insulin levels by going low carb, because carbohydrate is the macronutrient which is responsible for maximum secretion of serum insulin throughout the day. Now what happens is, when you get into a low carb diet, your serum insulin level falls and remain low throughout the day, and that activates the metabolic switch. Now it is very interesting to know and to spread this awareness that our body is like a double engine, an engine which can utilize two fuels, like a hybrid engine. So Toyota has a hybrid engine car, just like that. It can also utilize battery and diesel or petrol. Like, we imagine our body, you don't have to imagine, our body can utilize both glucose and fat breakdown bodies known as ketone bodies. So a body can use two fuels, and by going low carb, you are doing a powerful hormonal intervention. It's not a casual thing. So you are switching that, you are activating that metabolic switch, which allows your body from to switch over from glucose as a fuel to ketones as a fuel. Now this ketone is a much better long-lasting fuel. A comparison would be, glucose is like a matchstick. You light up a matchstick, it quickly lights up and then it is gone again. You need more matchsticks to keep the darkness out. Whereas lighting the ketones is lighting a log of fire. So once it is lighted, it's difficult to light it, no doubt. But once it is lighted, your fire will last night long as the darkness is there. So that's how I give the simile. Right. So that is what a low carb does for you. It is just, it's not a casual thing. It activates the metabolic switch. It is a very powerful intervention.
Right. So for our viewers who are very new to the whole concept of low carb, who must have heard from somebody that low carb or keto is good for weight loss, is good for diabetes, is good for PCOD. Like a very simple example, when I was diagnosed with PCOD, I went to my doctor, she gave me medication, she explained me what the problem is. And she said, you know what, go and lose some weight. Right? When somebody is diagnosed with diabetes, your doctor gives you medication, your doctor gives you some advice, and then they say, why don't you go and lose some weight? You have hypertension, same thing. You have sleep apnea, same thing. So everybody says go and lose some weight because we are targeting good health. Or it's just that in this whole pandemic, everybody says, oh God, you know, I'm sitting at home and I put on weight. Right? So let us understand, why do we put on weight? Like you said that, yes, we can switch from glucose to ketones. There is that metabolic switch. But just a little background. Why do we put on weight? We did not have obesity issues in the 50s and the 60s. It's so recent that obesity is everywhere. It's no more an age thing. It's, you know, it starts with small children as well. And it's not that suddenly we are just eating and eating and eating. Of course, we are eating a lot. But what is it? Why is the world putting on weight? Like just a common person, everybody who comes to me says, I don't know why I'm putting on weight. I mean, I just eat small meals. Why exactly are we getting obese?
Yeah. It is, I think, one of the most important health questions you can ever address. Why do we get fat? Why do we have this excess fat in our body, which is harmful to us? Now, several things have happened in the last 40, 50 years, let us say last 30 years, which has caused this weight gain. So, the main thing is nutrition related, because what has changed over the last 30 years is the way we eat. Especially in India, several changes have occurred. I will concentrate in India because we are here. In the 1970s and 80s, what happened was we kind of moved away from the traditional way of eating. First of all, we used to eat, say, two or three meals a day, and those were solid good meals prepared at home. Our grandmothers and mothers, what they used to cook were solid meals, and we used to use traditional cooking medium like ghee, like coconut oil, other oils which were, you know, prepared locally. Now, we first of all moved away from that. We were adopting a Western lifestyle very slowly, wherein we started eating food outside. And not only that, we also started eating small meals, more meals throughout the day. Another thing what happened that was incidentally is that the rice and the wheat also became genetically modified. So several changes occurred in the 1980s and 90s. Another major change which occurred, I would say, is if you remember that time, those so-called healthy vegetable oils were marketed. And we moved away from our traditional cooking media to heart healthy oils, you know, which was splattered all over the media and everyone told us about. So there was this definite shift in the cooking medium. There was definite shift from our, you know, eating patterns. And another thing happened in the Western countries during that time, this low-fat craze was going on. Because of that is another story, how this low-fat craze came about. So for some reason, for a very, very flawed study, I would say, the cholesterol and saturated fats, they were blamed for heart disease. Now, in Western countries, they have a peculiar problem. If you take out the fat from their diet, the diet becomes absolutely tasteless. See, they do not have the culinary experience that we have. We have fantastic recipes. You can't beat the Indian recipes. So if you take away fat from our diet, we probably won't notice it. But their diet remove fat, they had to replace it with sugar. And they had this low, high fructose corn syrup to make it. So what happened was the low fat concept, instead of reducing heart disease and obesity in their countries, it just shot up from there. And as a matter of, because our doctors follow their guidelines and our guideline bodies also follow their guidelines. So during that time, what happened? We also incorporated the low fat thinking. So on one hand, we gave up our traditional cooking media. We gave up our lifestyle, started eating more meals throughout the day. And we also were a victim of giving up the healthy fat. For their flawed study, today, an Indian middle class housewife is afraid of the yellow of the egg.
Yes.
Is it true or not true? Which is so, so ridiculous. I mean, why should you be afraid of a nature-made thing? For millions of years, eggs have been there and suddenly they've become bad for the heart. It just doesn't make sense. So this low-fat thing, what it did was, it took away the healthy cooking media, which is to protect us from this, the rice and the other, you know, the carbohydrate. We were always a carbohydrate-eating country. I mean, the whole Southeast Asia, China, Korea, India, we were eating rice for thousands of years. What happened all of a sudden? Now, this traditional cooking media, I believe, gave some amount of protection. And also, the older varieties of rice and all 50 years back or 100 years back had a much lower glycemic index. Today, the rice is just like sugar. It is polished. It is genetically modified. So is the wheat. And so are the fruits. So everything has changed. Today, whatever you eat as carbohydrate is just spiking up your insulin. So because carbohydrate, mind you, another basic fact I would like to tell everyone, that if you go deep into medical science, every doctor knows this. Some have forgotten, some have not. That of these micronutrients, there are essential amino acids. Essential means the things which cannot be manufactured in our body, we have to eat from outside. There are essential fatty acids. Certain fatty acids we cannot manufacture, so we must eat. But there are no essential carbohydrates. This is a fact, a medical fact. It is there in every biochemistry textbook, in every physiology textbook. It is there in the, if you follow the Western guidelines, it is there in the IOM, Institute of Medicine, guidelines, which all the other guidelines follow. So they have written very clearly, the lower limit of carbohydrate needed for survival in a human being is zero. Zero. So some a nutrient whose requirement is zero and which constitutes 70 to 80% of our diet, the body has to, you know, the pancreas is a very small organ. For millions of years, it has evolved only for emergency purpose, like, or occasional purpose. Like in, just before a winter, there would be some fruits which fell and we would gorge into that fruit so that we store up some energy for the coming winter for long periods of time. You know, we won't get food. So that is how we evolved. And then what has happened today is we are eating this non-essential nutrient. And this constitutes 70 to 80% of our diet. So what happens, I would say that there is a tolerance limit for everybody. And this varies from person to person. Now, if you, and this tolerance limit, what has happened is, due to all these changes which I have told you, the tolerance limit has kind of been taxed. you know. So for somebody who has a very good tolerance limit, even today, may not get diabetes, may not put on weight, may not get all the metabolic diseases. But for most people, what has happened is this tolerance limit is no more holding back, you know, the abnormality. What is happening, the food, the way we eat, what we eat, that has, that is spiking up the insulin levels, and which is remaining high throughout the day. Now, insulin remaining high throughout the day is a metabolic disaster.
Right.
It's a metabolic disaster, because that is the beginning of all problems. It stores fat. Insulin is a storage hormone. As long as insulin is high, the metabolic switch will never be activated. And if you go down to the cellular level, I quote Dr. Benjamin Bickman here. He wrote his recent book, Why We Get Sick, that even the mitochondria, which are the energy houses of every cell, become sluggish when the insulin levels are high. That means when your carbohydrate, you know, sugar levels remain high. So that is why I say that low carb is a very powerful intervention. It goes down to every cell in your body. That is how powerful it is. So these are the reasons why people got obese. And then what happens is, when you are keep on eating beyond your carbohydrate tolerance limit, your levels of insulin remain high. That means your insulin remaining high means your body is storing the excess of food as storage. So, and because your insulin remains high, your body cannot access that fat. So it is just like a small area which your body is accessing all the time, and that finishes, you feel hungry again. So the more small meals you eat, and more carbohydrates, especially the refined ones, anything that comes out of a packet, which is ultra processed food, and that is what we are eating. You go to the supermarket, or you go to the local pandukan, even in a village, all you get is everything out of a packet, whether it is a chips or a peanuts or deadly combination of not only refined carbohydrates but all the refined so-called vegetable oils.
Right.
There is nothing vegetable about these vegetable oils, mind you. So this deadly combination induces a state of inflammation, we call. Inflammation means a slow fire burning in your body. So all this weight you are putting on is just like putting your body on fire. And I will tell you one more very important thing about Indians. Now, in Western countries, when a person is obese, you can make out that that person is obese.
Yes.
In India, we have this, we are very lean, we have got very thin frames. You know, we have something known as thin outside but fat inside. It's a very nice word for it. Toffee. Toffee is thin outside, fat inside. So a thin person with a small pot belly. Sometimes not even the pot belly. So where is the fat, excess fat in this person? It is inside the abdomen. It is visceral fat, we call it. And the most dangerous is in the liver. So that is why we get fatty liver. So the excess of carbohydrates which we are eating gets converted into glycogen, and more excess of it gets converted into fat. And that is called de novo lipogenesis, and that occurs in the liver. And you find fatty liver nowadays in as teenagers, even pre-teenagers, because they eat this, they have become used to this junk food, you know, processed foods, and this cold drink, as we call it in the country, carbonated drinks, and that is just poison. So this is the cause of this obesity epidemic. And would you believe it that today the obese people, the problem is so much that the obese people actually outnumber those who are not obese globally. And India also, we are fast approaching that stage. And as far as the pandemic is concerned, since you mentioned, the number one risk factor of all the risk factors which make you vulnerable is obesity. Or I would say, not obesity, there is a better word, that is overfat. Overfat in our country, you will find that, as I said, in Western countries, say out of 100, only 20% would be the thin fat ones. In our country, it is 50-50. Half of us would be thin and fat, and half of that you can make out. So these thin and fat people, they think that they are lean, they are very healthy, but actually they are not, because their insulin levels are high, and they are lean and thin. They think they are healthy, but they are not, and they also are very much prone to diabetes and obesity. This small amount of excess fat. So that is something to be aware of.
So
I hope I got through why people get fat. Right. It is overeating of an unnecessary nutrient in one line.
Correct. And that unnecessary nutrient is carbohydrate, which makes the base of our food pyramid.
Yeah.
You know, when you say that, what is the base of our food pyramid? What is it that we teach our kids in school? Yeah. Carbohydrates, you know, your bread, pasta, rice, grains, that's the base of your pyramid, of your food pyramid. And like you rightly said, we are eating a non-essential nutrient, and that is the base of our diet. That is the macro of our diet, you know.
Right.
So in every, whether a vegetarian food plate or a non-vegetarian food plate, for example, a non-veg biryani is like 80% rice and 20% meat. Right, a vegetarian meal is your rice, your chapati, your puri. So we are more of grains, and that nutrient we do not need. Like you're saying that we store fat, and that fat is what we have to use. So when you say you lost 25 kgs, so what really happened? Your body used that 25 kgs of fat as energy, and you were able to do that by switching that metabolic switch. So switching from this instant fuel to a slow burning log, the log which is the fat in our own body. So whenever somebody comes to you and says, I want to lose fat, which means that what, you know, it cannot evaporate. So you have to use it. You have to use it as a fuel. And like you mentioned, this thing about why we feel hungry every 2 hours. So the ones who are eating very high carbohydrate, like small sandwiches, one chapati, cereals, poha, idli, puri, just the small portion control size. So they are using the glucose in the body, which is like the matchstick. Every 2 hours, you need to refuel it. And unless we don't switch, we will not be able to reach the fat in our body. So how do we reach the fat in our body? How do we switch this metabolic switch? Of course, low carb is, but why does low carb work? Why does a keto diet work?
But there is another actually very important concept which needs to be cleared. It is this calorie thing. So everybody tells you to count calories. So this the whole calorie concept is not scientific, because it was used, you know, this calorie meters and all were used in an animal experiment, which kind of burned foods. Our body is not a one compartmental model. So it is a two compartmental model, and there's a lot of hormones and other chemicals involved. So just, you know, calories in and calories out, our body doesn't work that way. So the most common advice, you know, as you have said, lose some weight. So doctor, how do I lose some weight? So nothing, you just eat less and you exercise more.
Yes. Go to the gym.
Go to the gym. So this particular advice, I think, has been the biggest failure of all nutritional advices. Because all the studies, there were people tried to study it also. All the studies which done, people started to study in two ways. If you read Gary Taubes, you will know all these studies. Huge amount of studies were done. First part of the studies were eat less studies. So whenever people try to eat less, what happened was they felt hungry, and they try to make up. And when they try to make up, they ate more than what they should have eaten. And when you look at the exercise more studies, you know, what happened was ultimately the scientists who advocated, they started telling that as you age more and more, you have to run more and more. At the graph, if you see, if you say with every passing year, you will almost have to run a marathon every day. So that is hardly practical. Something was very wrong. Both were not addressing the real cause of weight gain. We do not gain weight, you know, because we eat more. We gain weight because our metabolism has gone wrong.
Right.
So, and chronic hyperinsulinemia. So that, once you address, this calorie counting becomes useless. See, I lost weight not by counting calories.
And not by exercising.
Neither by any organized exercise.
Right.
Your human body is meant to move. If you do the things which you are supposed to do throughout the day, you will be active. So, and you will feel like moving. When your metabolism is right, your body will feel, I should go, I should do. You won't feel like sitting, you won't feel lazy at all. So what has gone wrong is this calorie in, calories out concept. So that is one thing. So when you go low carb, what happens is your carbohydrate portion is gone. So, and then another people have this mistaken idea. Low carb means a very high protein diet. Not necessarily. What is high is a fat. So fat is, as I told you, like the log, fat is your new health paradigm. The good, healthy, saturated fat, which are there all around for us to eat. We used to eat and cook in ghee. We used to eat butter, makhan, and that is a part of our culture. Makhan is very much a part of our culture. And the other...
Coconut oil, mustard oil.
Coconut oil, and for those who are non-vegetarians, starting from eggs. Eggs is a fantastic, it is a reference protein. It is a reference food. There is no food like eggs. So, and the eggs which come with the non-vegetarian meat or whatever. So that, whatever exists in nature, and I have a word for them also, that if you notice that in nature, the meat and the fat exist together.
Right.
The carbohydrates do not exist.
Yeah. Like a fatty protein. So egg has fat and it has...
In there. It doesn't exist. So what happens is, when you eat such kind of food which nature provides you, your hunger disappears. If you eat a low carbohydrate and a high fat meal, high fat doesn't have to be so much of fat in your plate. If you take some vegetables, put a spoonful of ghee in it, that becomes very tasty, an additional spoonful that is. And see, it is not by the quantity, but by the percentage of fat, which becomes a high fat diet. So that will satisfy you more, because fat stimulates the satiety center more than anything else. So a very simple experiment. Suppose I give you a small katora of ghee, and I challenge you, come on, how many spoonfuls can you take? So you'll say one teaspoonful, two, or just because I'm challenging you, you'll take another two, but not more than that. Something makes you stop, right? And that something is a feedback loop, which exists in our body for fat. The feedback loop also exists in our body for, after some time, for the proteins. We have proteins, but we cannot have unlimited amount. But mind you, for carbohydrates, there is no feedback loop like that, because our bodies were not meant to eat it. So what happens? You stop when you feel physically full. Or a pet barrier. I am full. So that is when too much of non-essential nutrient has gone in. So that is why when you eat food which is meant to be eaten by you, I always say this, that food is species specific. Every species is meant to eat a particular type of food. It's a very deep thought. You have to really think about this thought, and I will not tell you the full meaning of what I'm trying to say, but that would be too drastic. But food is species specific, and that is how it has been for millions of years. So when we eat food which we are meant to eat, our hunger will be satisfied naturally. Then you need to count calories. Stop eating when you are full. That's what I did. When I ate the food which I, you know, cut out the carbs and increase the fat, protein remaining the same or little more, then I would stop eating when I felt like stopped eating. That's it. And that feeling will continue throughout till the next meal. You won't feel hungry. You won't feel hungry. Mm-hmm. Even, you know, you could extend it a little more if you wanted. Right. That's another challenge. So that is how I continued eating and just cut out the rice and the dal.
Right.
Even the dal and the wheat, of course, everything I cut out. My meal would be, I would use vegetables as fillers and the fish and the eggs and the other meat, what is there as the main protein source. Whatever hunger I would get, fill it up with green leafy vegetables. That's how I started.
So, doctor, you're saying that obesity is a hormonal issue. It is not lack of willpower and lack of knowledge that we have experienced in the past, you know. So anybody who is like trying to lose weight and going on this low fat diet with all willpower and discipline and tracking everything that they are eating, you know, one chapati, one teaspoon, half this, half that, you know, they are doing all of that, for some time they do manage to lose weight, right? But as you said, one fine day, you know, that discipline goes out of the window. We all have gone through those kind of diet, and that is exactly, and then people feel so bad about themselves. They just feel that, oh, I don't have the willpower. I am not able to do it. But then I am hungry every 2 hours, and those small portions are not giving me satiety. Like you said, we are not evolved to have satiety through carbohydrates. And that's the reason we can eat like, I can, even today after being on low carb and keto, I can probably eat like 3 portions of McDonald's French fries servings. You know, if I just sit to do that, I can really do that. But ask me to eat 3 portions of eggs, I'll be full with some 4 eggs fried in butter. I'll be full. I can't have a bite anymore. But I can munch on popcorn, those big buckets that we take, and we can go on throughout the movie, and we can just finish it. There's no satiety hormone. So, Dr. Das, for our viewers who are like really trying to exercise and lose weight, who are really logging in their time, they are running, they are doing this, how can they lose weight by not focusing on exercise? And how are they able to get their insulin levels down? You said that once they get their insulin levels down is when the fat comes out of the fat cells into your body. So how can they do that? How do they target that?
Yeah, let me tell you one thing, that exercise has got tons of benefits, plenty of benefits. I will not disagree on that. But weight loss is not amongst them. That you have to remember. All this gymming and sweating and panting, they will only work when your diet is right. When you cannot outrun a bad diet. It is a very famous saying which all low carbers all over the world will say. So your diet has to be right, then only. And there is another very good saying that abs, you know, which you are looking for, you know, abs are made in the kitchen, not in the gym. So you have to put your diet right. So another thing which you must remember, that all the exercises cannot take away the liver fat, the visceral fat. You cannot exercise your liver by running. You can exercise your liver by not eating, just by fasting, or just by putting the serum insulin down. So that is why exercising does not work. Exercise will make you feel good. It will give you a nice, a good stamina, and there's a good feel good. You know, you have a good feeling, and you feel like doing it again. Makes you active. Keeps your muscles toned. It's very important, and also gives you a certain amount of insulin sensitivity, which is excellent. But that would be overcome if you were, you know, end of the workout in the gym, you take that sugary drink which they give you.
Right.
Everything lost. You go for a vigorous morning walk and stop at the Sadaji Dhaba for 2 jalebis and 2 samosas. So if you have hardly spent 150-200 calories after walking for 1 hour, if you count calories, and then you have two jalebis, two samosas must be 2000 calories.
Right.
Not that bad, but still.
Or even just come back home and have a low fat milk with cornflakes.
Ah, the disaster. Cornflakes is a disaster.
Yeah, the K cornflakes. I think there is K cornflakes for weight loss and muesli with some low fat toned milk. You have that and you feel so good that, oh, you worked out. And after 2 hours, you're just so crazy. You're hungry. And we have that, right? We have a 5-star ad which says that you're hangry, which means you're so hungry that you're irritated and you eat a 5-star. And now we all are eating 5-stars when we are hungry. Only to be hungry again and having another 5-star.
So what happens is when you eat like this, your insulin levels, you know, keep on. It never comes down and it never touches that log at all. Never touches the real source of the ketones, which really help you. And there is a lot of misunderstanding about these ketones because doctors confuse it with something known as diabetic ketoacidosis. So if you know, try to talk to a doctor, they say no, ketones and ketogenic diets, they will confuse. So that is a different thing. But if you really understand that this is the reason why we get fat, it is because you don't get fat because of what you eat it is of your own fault. You get fat because your eating pattern has now become such that your insulin levels remain high throughout the day, which keeps on storing your excess food into fat. And more than fat outside, it stores fat in the liver and in the abdominal organs. And this gives rise to the harmful part of the obesity. So that is the problem. And that gives rise to other metabolic problems. It gives rise to diabetes, gives rise to heart disease. In ladies, it gives rise to PCOS and a host of other all metabolic issues. So that has to be really, really looked into, because we have really become sick. Our country, our population is suffering of these metabolic problems. If you are in a hospital like me, you will know that it is the sickness is going up every day and no health system is geared to handle it. We just cannot handle it. The kind of complications which are going to happen because of obesity, because of diabetes, and they're all related, because of cancer, we cannot handle it. So it is going to be a disaster. I'm sorry to put in such a serious note, but it is. And the solution is not very difficult. I will not say it is very simple. It is difficult. Many patients come and tell me that, so if I don't eat rice and chapati, what am I going to eat? So it is not simple. So we have to tell them. So it is a vexing issue. So I try and find out various means and ways to, you know, get around that, to what to do. So sometimes I explain that the cost of eating a good meal today would compensate for your cost of medications tomorrow.
Excellent.
But that is, some people get convinced, but some don't. So for them, I have to devise something else. So it is a problem. But I think everybody will have to find a way around this. But the fact, bottom line remains, that we are eating a non-essential nutrient and our tolerance limit, which was good before, has come down. So that is what is giving rise to the problem. Our grandmothers never had this problem despite of eating rice throughout their lives.
Yes.
But we are having this problem. Our environment has changed. Whatever we are getting to eat is become very, very polluted, very, very poisonous, I would say. That has given rise to the problem. So if we know that, then we can address it. So that is one aspect of the story. And the other thing, which also is a very powerful intervention, I cannot not mention it. I already mentioned it once. Is that is to extend the period of not eating.
Right.
That is a fasting or intermittent fasting. Now, it is very important to realize that over 3 million years, our bodies are 3 million years old. It's not just a few thousand years old. The Homo sapiens have had periods of prolonged fasting. That is how we evolved, you know. We used to get food only once in a while. And then prolonged periods would go without. Whenever we used to get food, we used to really feast. And then not eat for prolonged. So our bodies are actually much more adapted to not eating.
Right.
Than it is adapted to eating. Now you realize why our bodies are reacting, because we eat so many times throughout the day. You don't eat, your body will be fine after some time. You look at any animal, look at your pet dog, look at your pet cat. The moment it feels unwell, it will stop eating.
Yes.
That is a built-in reflex. So it allows the body to heal. Our bodies are fantastic healing machines. You know what is standing in the way? We ourselves. Because of our eating habits and because of our beliefs and because of so many things, we have to get out of the way and allow the body to heal. And Hippocrates, if I quote Hippocrates, he said that, you know, let food be thy medicine. Okay. And he said another thing which many people don't know, that if you eat when you are ill, when you are sick, you are feeding the sickness. If you eat when you are sick, you are feeding the sickness. So fasting is, if I said that low carb is a very powerful tool, then I would say fasting is the most powerful tool. It is much more powerful than any medicine to deal with the metabolic problems. Much more powerful than any of the diabetic medications to treat diabetes. Much more powerful than any of the antihypertensive medicines. Much more powerful than any of the antacids. So that is how powerful. Because once again, it is not a casual thing. It is a hormonal intervention. You are bringing down your insulin levels and keeping it that way as long as you are fasting. So there are a lot of myths about fasting. Maybe we can discuss that some other time. But it is a fantastic and more powerful tool. And we have been fasting for thousands of years. It is a part of every culture, every religion. Not only ours, all over the world. So, a low-carb ketogenic diet along with intermittent fasting, these are like two machine guns in your hands.
Right. With which we can fight all the diseases. So, Dr. Das, you are a big proponent of fasting, of course, and fasting has been one of the most important tool of my journey in low carb, my journey in weight loss. Somebody who wants to start fasting, you have said this in a few of your podcasts, as to how first you go low carb, you go keto, and then slowly you start to fast. Now, in today's date, if we go to see an average person, their dinner time is like 10 in the night, and then morning 8 o'clock is breakfast. So there's not even a 12-hour window, you know, and they need breakfast in the morning. They feel hungry. So there are these lot of nutritionists advice that say that eat as soon as you wake up to start your metabolism. And here you are saying fast as long as you can. So for our viewers who have heard this advice and who are almost eating even if they are not hungry, can you just throw some light on that?
Yeah. Actually, breakfast is a very new concept in the evolution of Homo sapiens. Once again, I would say. It's less than 150 or 200 years old and very much a marketed concept also. That you must, first thing you must get up in the morning and eat. No, you observe any species from any animal. They get up in the morning and they have to go and hunt their food. And it was also for us, even a couple of hundred years back, we go out and get our breakfast and earn it. So now what has happened is breakfast somehow has been marketed in such a way that it has gone into our psyche that, you know, breakfast is the most important meal of the day. But, you know, when you wake up in the morning, after, say, 8 hours of not eating, like you had your, as you said, had you finished your meal, dinner by 10 p.m., now you have this wonderful gift where your insulin levels are low. And instead of continuing with that for some time, you know, by allowing the body to tap into, you know, deplete the glycogen stored in the liver and the muscle, and tap into the fat which is already there, we again eat something. So what happens? The whole process is thrown out of, you know, sync. So again the insulin level goes up. And once the insulin level goes, the body starts storing fat again. So the burning, whatever little fat burning which was happening at the end of 8 hours stops. And then if you eat at these so-called cereals and other things in the morning, and you know those high, most of our breakfast is also carbohydrate oriented, you know this, and then what happens after at 10 o'clock again you feel hungry, and maybe you're in your office, food is so plentifully available, you know, the snacks will come and the sweets will come, you are carrying your 5-star, so that's the end of your fat burning story. So instead, if you could continue the period of low insulin or the not eating for, it takes minimum 14 hours, 12 to 14 hours, or I would say 16 hours is the best to start fasting. So that would, you know, allow the body every day a period of 3-4 hours where it would deplete your stored fat, at least if not tap into the existing fat. So that would give you much more healthy levels of insulin, and that would allow you not only every day to eat healthily but also feel not hungry by going. So once, and that metabolism thing, all the studies of fasting have shown that the metabolism actually goes up when you fast. It is not affected. Your metabolism goes up. Yeah, there are so many good effects of fasting, and mind you, this is now published in the mainstream medical journals. So there is no excuse not to advocate fasting. No longer can a doctor say that don't skip breakfast. Fasting is dangerous. No, it is. I would refer to a NEJM publication in December 2019. which is a review article on the effects of fasting on aging and disease. It's a fantastic article which everybody must read. So, and that has given so much of beneficial effects of fasting on every metabolic disease, that, and they want to, actually they have said that this should be taught to all doctors, and all doctors should prescribe fasting to their patients as a approach to metabolic diseases. So there is no reason not to fast.
Right. And
it's just how to train yourself to fast. That's all.
Right. So I always say, and like you also mentioned in your podcast, that do not take this as a medical advice. Please work with a low carb doctor, work with a low carb nutritionist. And like 14 to 16 hours, that's like missing a breakfast and having lunch, directly having lunch. Just skipping a meal, we can't even really call it fasting, but okay, we are so used to eating that even skipping one meal is now fasting, but there are so many benefits to it. So Dr. Das, how does your fasting routine look like now?
Well, at the moment I eat only one meal a day, so that's 22 hours of fasting, 22-23 hours. So, but it did not happen in one day.
Right.
As I had to ease, I always say, tell people not to do abruptly. You must actually ease into it, you know. So this is how I did it. I gave up breakfast once a week. Just like that. For a month. And then made it twice a week. Then thrice a week. Like that. I mean, I didn't jump into it. So I was getting benefits from low carb, no doubt. But since I want to extend it, since I wanted to extend those benefits, so I took it slow and easy. So I did not have any problems, because it is very important to get into a low carb diet first,
right,
and
get fat adapted.
And that is when you will not feel hungry. So why do we eat? Because we feel hungry. So, and if you do it properly, fasting will not make you feel hungry. That is the whole idea. If you are fasting and feeling hungry all the time, then there is no point. I mean, you will not be able to do
it. Then we are again going back to the willpower part, you know, which goes out of the window someday.
Remember that once you are by low carb, by ketogenic diet, your insulin is normalized and your body is tapping into the body fat already. So that those ketones will not make you feel hungry. And they will make you feel, yes, I can go on. The world record for fasting is 380 days, I think, more than a year. And that was a 300 plus kg man. But he didn't feel hungry. I mean, other than some multivitamins, he didn't even have to take anything else. But that is one extreme case. But easily one can fast up to 16 hours, then extend it up to 20 hours. And I do on a regular basis, one meal a day. And I do once in a while 48 hours or 72 hours. But that is once in a while, planned. Now, the best part of fasting in such a way is complete freedom from the thought of food. I get up in the morning, I don't have to think what I'm going to eat. I work the whole day, 12 hours, 16 hours a day I work sometimes. And the thought of food doesn't bother me. Once in a while I feel thirsty, I keep myself hydrated, water, liquor, tea, black coffee, without sugar and milk, of course. That's it. I mean, see, it's already 8:30, 8:40 p.m. I finished my meal last night at around 9 p.m. or something. I'm still not hungry.
So you're almost 24 hours into fasting now.
Yeah. And I have not even thought about food. So much so, one day so much of control will come that even if you see sweets, even if you see the so-called, the food which you would hunger after, go after, you will not feel like eating them. Like, I have a full department of doctors working, and there's a lot of food and sweets coming in every day. Every day there are some, but I don't eat them. So everyone knows that. So I tell them, you keep it, I will eat it in my eating window. So most of the time I don't touch the sweets. So that is how there's a social aspect to it also. You must be very tactful with your the people whom you interact every day. But once your metabolism is in order, you will not feel hungry. You will feel more energetic, because studies have shown that there is something, a chemical known as a noradrenaline. Like adrenaline, a noradrenaline is secreted. That gives you energy. And fasting is perhaps the best method of manufacturing growth hormone in your body. So that is also another amazing thing. People try to spend millions of dollars or millions of rupees into artificial growth hormones. This growth hormone keeps you young, keeps your mind focused. And so many, I could talk of fasting the whole day. I mean, the benefits, it is amazing benefits you get. It reduces your inflammation. It gives your brain something known as a neurotrophic factor, which increases the connection between neuronal cells. That means your brain, this is a common belief we have that when we grow old, your brain cells deteriorate and we can't remember things, we can't recall things. No, try fasting and see what happens, how sharp your brain becomes, how focused you are. So that is, the benefits are amazing. So, and what else? I mean, fasting is beneficial, pandemic also.
Can we fast at any age? Is it only for youngsters?
Not at all. It is for everybody. Anybody can fast. Our bodies will just adapt to it. Our bodies, this mainstream medicine article says that when you start fasting, it is like activating another switch which has been sleeping for millions of years. It says evolutionarily present, you know, switch is activated when you start fasting, and that gives you the beneficial effects of so many tackling so many metabolic diseases. Another very important aspect of fasting, for which one Japanese doctor got a Nobel Prize in 2016, is known as autophagy. Autophagy means eating your own wasted cells. So fasting after a certain period, like it starts getting activated at around 24 to 25 hours and plateaus at 72 hours. That is what the present research is. So this autophagy can kind of remove all the excess of, you know, waste cells, which is constantly being produced by the body, metabolic wastes, and it can give rise to a reset immune system. So your immune system will regenerate kind of, and you will be much more a healthy person when you regularly have extended fasts. You know, many religions have it, even in our country. You know, I think the Jains have it. They fast for 7 days at a stretch. So many, and that is a complete reset of the immune system. That is what scientifically has been believed. Even the Ramzan fast, there's a lot of studies have been done in the Ramzan fast, and they have shown that even the 12 hours, not a very long fast, even the 12 to 14 hour fast has given rise to a lot of benefits. Lipid profile improved, weight loss occurred, and so many other benefits. So there is no reason why one should not advocate fasting. So autophagy is just another huge benefit. Huge benefit. So
right. And and now immunity is such a big topic. Everybody is talking about immunity. We are people are just going to the medical stores and buying everything that is available across the counter, some herbal oils, and then there are teas, and I don't know, there are some mix, and we are doing everything possibly that we can to develop a good immune system. And here we can like just fast, and yeah, it's free. It's free. Just
there is a slight controversy. I was asked this question about fasting in a pandemic, because there were some studies which showed that prolonged fasting, you know, more than 48 hours or more than 78 hours, can bring down the WBC count a little bit. Okay. Yeah, but that is not applicable to 24 to 36 hours of fasting. Okay. No, you could easily do one meal a day, or 16:8 is just fine in a pandemic. Okay. Because there is a virus going around, and if the WBC cells are low, that was a theoretical objection to fasting during pandemic. But all the observations which were made of the WBC count being low were made in people who had fasted for more than 48 hours or more than 72 hours. So it really doesn't apply to 16:8 or one meal a day. So one can fast. I have been doing it for fasting or lockdown or no lockdown, but one can fast easily for 16 hours a day and can have much better immune system, immune health, and that is, mind you, your best bet against the pandemic. If you lose weight by a low carb diet and fasting, it is your best possible vaccine. What we have today, we don't have a vaccine as yet, but till we have a vaccine, this is what you can do. Mind you, why obesity is the number one factor? Because these fat cells, they have this receptor, this ACE2 receptor, which the doctors are telling. So, and these receptors are very high in the fat cells. So what happens? The fat cells allow the virus to go in and multiply. And that is why in obese patients, even if they are young, the immune reaction is so much that the cytokine storm, as we are talking about, is very vicious in them, which is why obesity becomes the number one factor. So that is the reason why one should do everything to reduce weight, even during the pandemic. There is no, it's not an excuse to say that I've been eating and putting on weight. If you just eat right, you can lose weight. and you can give yourself this kind of immunity which is already there in your body. So that will help you I will not guarantee that it will not get the virus. Nobody can. And now scientists are saying that it is not a question of when, and it's not a question of if, it's just a question of when. Okay. So when the day comes, you will be best equipped. So equip yourself for that day, so that if it hits you, it's not going to affect you much. Your body immunity will be able to fight it. So that is the extent to which a low-carb ketogenic diet and fasting can do for you.
Doctor, something like this coming from you is such a great assurance to a common person who is so scared of keto, who is so scared of low carb, who are so scared of even skipping one snack in between. And 16, like you're saying, 16-8, which is 16 hours of fast and 8 hours of your eating window. And if you just skip your breakfast and directly start with lunch, one should be able to do it. We can gradually move into it. But like you said, this is the time where we have to really take our health into our hands. There cannot be a bigger eye-opener than the COVID times to universally tell us that something is seriously wrong with the way we are managing our life and our...
Actually, I always say that the real pandemic is the metabolic diseases that we are suffering from. The virus is just riding on it. That's all. So if you address that, the virus will not give you a difficult time. So that needs to be, and that is perhaps the biggest concern that we have today. And addressing a low carb way is a fantastic approach. That is what I would say. And now, whoever is listening on this channel, whoever is listening, spreading the word, there is, as I said, there is no reason not to do it. Please talk with your doctor who says that this is wrong advice. It is there in the medical literature now. It is there. Everything in medical science comes very, very slow. Like, for example, in 2015, the American Heart Association declared that cholesterol is no longer a nutrient of concern. That means dietary cholesterol does not cause heart disease. But has it translated to practice? No. So it's very slow to happen.
Right. In fact, even the egg, they said, now you can eat egg. But that information has not really come down to the last level. People are still scared of eating eggs.
So even this will take a long time to come. But it has already been published in journals. And it is there in the literature that a low carbohydrate diet. And even there is a term for it. It's called therapeutic carbohydrate reduction. That means you deliberately reduce the carbohydrate as a treatment. That is the approach. And that is very much evidence-based. And intermittent fasting is evidence-based. So there is no reason not to do it. So that has to be, awareness has to spread. The people have to know. The doctors have to change their thinking and start practicing. So our job, is to spread the awareness. That's all we can do.
Dr. Das, just a few lines from you as to, for people who think that low carb keto is a very Western way of eating and it cannot be sustained in a Indian food habits or an Indian eating culture. Of course, you are a great example. The whole idea of this podcast is like, talking about people in India who are able to do this. Just some views on that.
Yeah, see, our culture is, we have a fantastic culture. And like every culture, celebration, food is a part of our culture. Like food is an emotion. Everyone says food is not only something about eating, it is about sharing feelings. When people get together, they eat together and they celebrate, and that creates a bond. So that is culture, and that is culture all over the world. And we have our own eating culture and history. and it is fantastic. I have nothing against it. But as I told you, a drastic change has occurred in our environment. So our culture, what has happened is the culture, the traditional things remaining, certain other influences have given rise to these diseases. So if we have a eating culture which is making us suffer, we have to pause and give it a rethink. So is it really worth suffering so much? You know, I'm sure if I asked each and every person individually, are you willing to live a life without medicines? Almost everybody would say yes. Only a very casual person who says, nay, doctor, give me some medicines. I'll eat what I want to eat. But most people, they say that I don't want to suffer from diabetes. I don't want to be obese. I don't want to. So this traditional way of eating and the huge change that has occurred is given rise to a lot of suffering. So maybe this suffering can make us pause and think, make us think that maybe we have gone wrong somewhere, or things have gone wrong somewhere. And the only way to correct it is not medicines, because this is not a bug or a germ here that we can kill with antibiotics. And that is a mistake as modern medicine, as a doctor, I'm admitting, and that we have done, that we tried to apply that antibiotic culture or the thought or the method into metabolic diseases. Like if there was staphylococcus, we would give penicillin. We have come from that era, and that was fantastically successful. And we have tried to apply it in modern medicine. But modern medicine, what it does is just like, as I said, giving crocin. We don't actually treat the cause of the fever. So if you in diabetes, if you just treat the blood sugar, it's just like giving crocin for fever. You are bringing down the sugar from the blood. But where is the sugar going? It is not going away from the body. It is going to your kidneys, it is going to your eyes, going to your heart, going to your brain, and causing end organ damage there. So this is a serious thing which is happening. So we need to rethink, and that is the where we have to give it a pause and think that if all this kind of eating is making us suffer, then let us change the way of eating. If we have to eat, then you know, at least I would say we should go back to how our parents or grandparents used to eat. They also used to have this culture, but they would not eat as much as we do now. They would not eat all the food. In fact, there is a definition of real food means whatever your grandmother would not recognize as food on the table. We all eat out of packets, and those are ultra processed food. So eating culture does not mean that we should eat the modern processed food. We could become more traditional and we could eat less number of times. Yes, as we have evolved, feasting, let there be feasting, but let there be fasting too. That would bring us back to our metabolic health. Okay, so now, I wanted to ask something.
Yeah, so I was saying that let's say I really want to eat some carbs, or I don't want to go very low carb. I want to have that one bowl of rice or two chapatis or a little bit of sweet. So does fasting help me there? How is it?
While it is best not to eat, that is the best option. But then once in a while, if you feel like doing it, the study which I was telling you about, which came out in December last year, that has also mentioned that if you fast throughout the day, and if fasting is a regular practice that you have incorporated in your life, the benefits of that fasting throughout the day will also be carried over to the eating window from your fasting window. That means your insulin will be more sensitive and will cause less damage then had you not fasted when you eat that bowl of rice which you are craving for. So okay, if you allow yourself once in a while, fine. So, but remember that if you have fasted, you will get more benefit. If you had not fasted, your harmful effects would have been more. So you can allow yourself once in a while, yes. But if you continue to fast, I hope one day you will not feel that craving again. So your craving itself will go away. That is the day when you really achieve the benefits of fasting.
Right. Excellent. Dr. Das, thank you for taking out the time today. And you are also doing a podcast series, which is Are You As Healthy As Can Be? On that platform, there are a lot of doctors and there are other normal people also who can attend that. Can you talk a little bit about...
Most join me, all the viewers, you can leave a link below when you post this video. I'll give you the link and it is open for everyone. I use the platform because there are doctors and there are other people also, general people also, so that I can get access to everybody. And I've been doing it for more than a month or so, quite a few episodes now, where I address all the metabolic diseases. And right now I have started a series on diabetes. So I'll be continuing with that for some time. And if you want to watch, you're most welcome.
Excellent. Excellent. And Dr. Das, if someone wants to connect with you, are you available on...
I am available on my social media, Facebook, Twitter. I can give you the...
Sure.
You can share it. And I have a Facebook group known as Are You As Healthy As Can Be?
Oh.
So that also you can join, and I can, whatever queries you have, you can post it there. I will answer it as soon as possible, and we could continue. So I would say this is not the end of the conversation.
Of course not.
Let this be just the beginning, and let us all together, you, Michelle, me, and all those who are listening, let us spread this awareness. Let us do our little bit to make this world a more healthy place, a more healthy for everyone to live in, you know. Medicines are not the answer. Medicine is not healthcare. Medicine is sick care, I always say. Food is healthcare. So let us do that.
Thank you, Dr. Das. You've given so much of information. And like you said, food, let us use food as medicine. Let us feast. Let us fast. Let us use low carb, keto, and fasting. Let us get fat adapted. And this is just a small initiative in spreading awareness. I have also been into low carb for like 5 years. And like you know, for us, it was always that we had to look international for advice, for understanding. And this is just locally that I want to do a small bit. So all our viewers, the link to Dr. Das' Facebook group, the series of these videos, that YouTube channel, to your Twitter account and Instagram account, we will share it below in the show notes. Please like and share your comments in the feedback below. Share this video with your friends and family. This is just a short introduction video. We are going to do really detailed videos with Dr. Das, and we are going to have a series of them addressing each and every topic. He's also doing a great series with each and every topic on Are You As Healthy As Can Be, that podcast as well. So do subscribe to our channel. And Dr. Das, towards the end, one small piece of advice for anyone who's saying, I want to lose weight. What do you want to say?
It's very much possible. Because you can do it. You can lose any amount of weight that you want to do. And I always say, you have to get desperate enough to do it. If you really want it, yes.
Right. So thank you, Dr. Das. I think you are now 24 hours past into your fasting. into your fasting. So enjoy your dinner, and thank you so much for taking out the time. I'm sure you're in midst of a busy schedule, so thanks a lot. We looking forward to see you on this show again.
Me too. Thank you very much. It was a pleasure. And thank you once again.
Good night. Thank you. Good night.